This program deals with themes of an adult nature and is intended for a mature audience.
If you like what you watch, then don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter for the latest updates on the KTPF Community Talk Show. Remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel for our new weekly radio shows. To accompany the KTPF Community Talk Show, we now have our own free magazine to view online or download for free. Visit our website for more details. Also, the KTPF Community Talk Show is supported by Phenomenon Magazine and Beyond Parazine, available online now. The comments and views expressed on the KTPF Community Talk Show are those of the people that make them and do not necessarily reflect the views of ourselves or of our sponsors.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
They've landed.
You're in the right place. Online, on the web, and on air. All over the world.
Talk radio. You hear us, we hear you.
Yeah, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another edition of the KTPF Community Talk Show, live and uncensored on www.ktpf.co.uk. Broadcasting on KTPF Radio, Worsley Radio, and DM Radio in New Jersey, USA. My name is Suzanne.
And I'm Steve.
And over in Essex, we have our regular co-host, parapsychologist and historian, and not feeling too good, Andy Mercer.
Hello, feeling old and grey.
Good evening, Andy.
Hello. Yeah, I don't know what it is. I just feel bleh. I mean, as I said to you earlier, it's like I feel like I've been drinking heavily the night before, and this is like a hangover the next day, so I've not been drinking at all. So I don't know where it's come from, but it's kind of lethargic, achy, kind of almost like a cold without a cold, if you know what I mean. And I feel a bit bleh, but there we go. Not being helped at all by the bloody football this afternoon, but we won't go into that.
Oops. well, on that note, we are here keeping the paranormal friendly each and every Sunday. So pull up a chair and relax with us while we bring you a show full of the supernatural, the paranormal, and other strange phenomena. We have sorted out our chat room so you can connect via Facebook, Twitter, Google, Yahoo, or even register to chat wing yourself. So just want to acknowledge those that are in the chat room at the moment. And don't forget, if you have any questions for us or our guest, you too can get involved with tonight's show via the chat room. Okay, just place your message in there and I will try and get through them as much as I can. Okay, just to let you know what's going on tonight, we're talking about shadow people. Now, shadow people are commonly reported as being seen through peripheral vision. And while you may feel something was there, the shadow person is either gone or quickly moves away from you by the time you turn your head. Now, Heidi Hollis is the first author to write about the topic of shadow people and the Hat Man, giving them both their descriptive names to describe these dark menaces now interrupting lives around the globe. Heidi is the first to have taken them on in her book, The Secret War, which details her personal story in dealing with shadow people and how positive and negative alien beings are connected to them. What do you reckon to that, Andy?
Sounds intriguing, I must admit. I'm looking forward to hearing what she has to say. Should be good.
So we're going to speak to Heidi round about 8:30 this evening. But without any further ado, we're going to hand you over to Steve for the observations.
I do. Well, I picked this first one up from about.com.
Okay.
I did. And if you want to see the video, there's a little link just underneath the picture on the page. Okay. In the video posted by Paranormal Camera, we see what appears to be the news footage of this aftermath of a car accident. The introductory text says that it was a fatal accident in which two people were injured and one person died, and that it took place in central Spain. As the wrecked red car is being towed off the road, we see a transparent figure walking away from the car to the right. Well, there's not much that's really known about this footage, except that it does appear to be the aftermath of a car accident. And the license plate indicates that it's not in the US, but we do not know for certain if it took place in central Spain, or whether anyone was actually killed in the wreck. We have only the introductory text's word for all that. As for the ghost, we can definitely see what appears to be an adult male figure, transparent, walking away from the red car to the right and off screen. But the question, of course, is it real ghost, or is it some kind of camera illusion or an outright hoax, in which the figure was added to the, with the video after editing software? But of the lack of information and detail about this video, I think we have to question its authenticity, they say. Well, I would have to agree with the lack of any real information. You have to wonder if this is real or not. So we'll just leave that to you guys.
Okay.
What is your surmising, Mr. Andy?
Very unconvinced by that one, I have to say. We say that if you can't trace any information about it other than a text and lacks any kind of anything you can follow up on, I'd say, nah. It could be either deliberate or otherwise, but I don't think it's anything you could really say about it other than, oh yeah, okay, it's an interesting video on YouTube, one of the billions that are out there, and that's about it, really.
Yeah, I totally agree. To me, it does smack a little bit of being... being faked, but
yeah,
as you say, there's no evidence one way or another. All we have is what we look at on this particular occasion.
Exactly.
This bizarre image of humanoids could be the world's first taken during an alien abduction.
Mm.
Paranormal investigators are looking into the case of a woman who is convinced she was abducted by aliens who took these photographs with her phone. Now, this is the aliens took the pictures. Not her.
Okay.
Just to prove they were there, I think. The unnamed woman claims 40 mysterious pictures, including one which appears to show a humanoid being appear on her mobile phone after she lost time to what she thinks was an alien abduction in her home. Her claims have been reported to the Mutual UFO Network, otherwise known as MUFON, a recognised global alien and paranormal investigation organisation, which also keeps a database of sightings and incidents. In a report to MUFON, she asked the organisation to take a look at the pictures. She says they were taken by beings and appeared on her phone. She said, "I believe I was abducted that night." The woman said she was at home in a condominium in Plymouth, Hancock County, Illinois, USA, when she had a row with her boyfriend, who chose to sleep in his van on the driveway. She said, "I was lighting a cigarette, that went down too quick, on the stove, and had the scratch to get in my other hand. The next thing I know, I'm waking up on the floor of my bathroom in a fetal position. The cigarette I had and the ticket were on the floor in the kitchen. Apparently, I'd dropped them." She said a few days later, she looked at her phone and found the 40 pictures that neither she nor her boyfriend had taken. She said, when you truly look at the detail, you see they are otherworldly and cannot be faked. I beg to disagree, unfortunately. The woman posted just 10 of the pictures with a report to MUFON. 9 of them appear to be blurred lights or colour, but one indicates a humanoid which appears to be lying down with an alien-like face. Although the pictures is of poor quality, the rest of the image could be simply blurred images of a light source that are taken in the dark. She did not comment on whom or what she thought the human-like figure was, or if it could have been her boyfriend snapped by someone unknown. It has already been picked up by the UFO websites, which have described the image as extremely creepy. Skeptics argued that the most claims of alien abductions include no real evidence of any actual happening other than the abductee losing time and then deducing they must have been taken by something. MUFON is investigating and has recorded the bizarre case as unresolved, naturally enough. Now, Andy.
Yes.
From a medical standpoint,
mm-hmm.
what could cause somebody to lose time apart from a blackout?
Well, that's the main thing, unconsciousness, whether caused by a blow to the head or taking on board some kind of medication that's had a reaction to, or, of course, getting blind drunk. Or you can, it is possible to just black out for no obvious reason. A sudden mild seizure can cause a blackout. Any one of a number of different things can cause somebody to suddenly lose consciousness. Just faint. I mean, sudden a drop in blood sugar levels can affect a person, cause them to pass out. So there's many reasons why that could happen. I look at the photographs themselves, it looks almost like someone just dropped their camera, really, just sort of very blurred. The only image that I thought looked halfway convincing was the one at the very bottom, but then apparently that's an artist's impression of a green alien person. So beyond that, not convinced an awful lot by that. I mean, I would say something might have happened to her, but whether it's alien abduction or just knocked herself out or something else happened, no way of knowing, really.
But if you'd have felt something coming and made her way to the bathroom, could she have forgotten that she'd gone there?
Very possibly. I mean, absolutely. I used to have a problem with fainting myself when I was much younger, in my sort of teens. Again, it kind of resolved itself eventually. But I had to remember one particular occasion, sitting in my bedroom watching something on TV, and the next minute I actually woke up lying face down on the bathroom floor. Now, the bathroom was next door, or opposite, I should say, so it wasn't far. I'd obviously gone there and either got up too quick or something, because it used to happen for no obvious reason. I've just passed out and woken up, and there I was lying on the bathroom floor feeling very woozy and very dizzy. So that's not far off what you're talking about, really. So I don't remember getting up going to the bathroom, but I was obviously on the way when I passed out. But
so apart from the actual photographs themselves, what she is describing is could be something medical.
Yeah, I would think more than likely that's all it really is. But we don't know, we weren't there. But pictures themselves look like you get sometimes if you've got a camera with a flash on and the flash hasn't gone off. You get this kind of blurring where there's too much light being allowed in, because it's the camera set for the flash to go off. So it stays open, digital shutter stays open slightly longer. But when there's no flash, it just takes lots of light in and it gets this kind of weird blurriness occurring. So
Okay. Next, for no 15 days of darkness, despite five planet alignment on January the 20th to the 20th of Feb, beginning on Wednesday, January the 20th, until five planets will align and the celestial phenomenon will be visible to the naked eye from Earth. However, like in the past planetary alignments, doomsday prophets would likely seize the chance to scare people that the event could possibly cause a catastrophe. Mercury, Venus, Mars and Jupiter and Saturn would all appear in one line from the horizon to the moon, according to I'm not sure if this is there should be a gap or not, but it's it looks like IFL science, which is IFL science. So if it's meant to be two words, I do apologize. It would be Mercury that would appear very, very close to the horizon. Venus and Jupiter would be easy to spot, and Mars would be easy to spot as well because of its distinctive red glow, says Dr. Alan Duffy, research fellow at the Swinburne University in Melbourne. To locate Mercury, Duffy advises astronomy buffs to locate an open spot away from tall buildings or trees, and says it is preferable to get away from city lights so Mercury's glow would not be drowned by light pollution. Duffy also says that those who would find one planet should hold up their arms so it's in line with the moon, and the rest of the planets would be in line with the arm. Those who would fail to see the alignment could see the celestial phenomenon repeat itself in August 2016 and October 2018, says Dr. Tanya Hill, senior curator at the Melbourne Planetarium. Planetary alignments in the past have sparked speculation of doomsday, ranging from asteroids hitting Earth, a planet wandering through the solar system, and even 15 days of darkness. In debunking these speculations, such as the planetary alignment on May 28th, 2015, which involved the Sun, Mercury and Saturn, but I would say it seemed it's time for the budding Lara Crofts to find the cradle of life.
Ooh, yeah.
do you remember the film? That's what happened then, wasn't it? That's what started it all, when the old planetary alignment.
It's always interesting how we seem to think that these planets lining up somehow are going to cause some disaster or catastrophe in the world. When you think about it, they're only visible from one place, from Earth. So, you know, if you happen to be sitting on the moon, for example, this alignment doesn't take place the same way. It's like the whole universe must be there around us. It goes back to the whole notion, sort of religious idea, that that the Earth is the center of the universe. And so anything that lines up is the universe lining up against us, when in fact, as we know, it's just we're one little tiny dot in an otherwise vast universe of millions and billions of tiny dots. So,
and we're not even in the middle.
I find that sort of thing really fascinating, that we always, even today, with our knowledge, still think that must mean something mystical alignment is going to cause some weirdness to occur.
Yeah. And as I say, we're not even in the middle.
Exactly.
Okay, here we go. A picture of a mysterious UFO that appeared to leave trail across the sky and left alien investigators baffled. An unnamed witness who photographed the flying object from a back garden on Monday immediately reported the sighting to the official investigators because they were so puzzled by it. In a brief report to the MUFON UFO network, the homeowner from New Orleans in America said it blocked out the sun's rays. The person said they observed the object activity in all lines of their vision. In the image, it looks like a so-called cigar-shaped UFO, which left trail almost like that of a plane. But the trail also appears to be lit up by sunlight. The witness said the object almost had the appearance of a start before fading. They added, watch star-like object doing a sharp turn, flying across the sky and fading. MUFON investigators have so far been unable to pin down what the object seen at 11:16 local time could be. They have listed the case as unresolved. New Orleans has been a hotbed of UFO sightings, according to MUFON database. It lists 36 sightings, 21 of which since 2010, dating as far back as 1965. Only in July 1893, two men reported seeing a jet of about 20,000 feet with another approaching that made an erratic movement. One of them said, from the opposite direction, we noticed what we thought was another jet heading right at it. They were about 5 miles apart when we first saw them. It looked like they were going about the same speed. Then they got about the length of 10 jets apart. The second jet made a 45-degree turn to the right and shot out of sight. We both looked at each other and knew right away that it was a UFO. Turned the subject to be going 3 times the speed after the turn. That day, I knew for sure that UFOs are real. Now, the little thing at the bottom there, and the old, what do you think? An alien spacecraft, 47%, a plane, 53%. Mm. Now, they said it blocked out the sun. And yet, the second picture, you can see the sun in the picture. So, it kind of didn't. Doesn't it? You can see it just below the, around the roof or whatever it was they were under.
I tell you what it reminds me of. You remember the Star Trek film where Kirk dies, the first one of the Next Generation? There's this ribbon thing that rips through the universe and it takes you on another dimension when it first appears in the sky over
the
other
planet. Yeah,
yeah, that's going to absorb them and take them off to this other reality. That's exactly what it looked like.
I would hope be telling people that they'll think this thing has come to haunt us and we're going to be taken away.
Another end of the world job.
Yes, end of the world.
It's the end of the world as we know it.
Well, there you go. That is me.
That is you.
So over to you for your two penneth, if you are doing it now.
I will do it now. It's not exactly a two penneth tonight, but we're going to do a bit of a remembrance tonight on the show. Now, today would have been the birthday of a good friend of ours, both personally and professionally. Mark Rodney had a keen interest in all things paranormal since witnessing his first UFO incident in Holton in Cheshire in 1971. And although the sighting turned out to be a fiery re-entry of a Russian booster rocket, it spurred him on to learn all he could about UFOs. And after 10 years of extensive reading and research, he decided to actively investigate for himself. He basically formed Para Projects, his own investigation team, in 2007. And whereas they would discover many important links between UFOs and other paranormal phenomena, which spurred him on to investigate other aspects of the paranormal, from ghosts and hauntings and UFOs to UFOs and phantom big cats, which they had quite a few big cats themselves around Holton. He'd mentioned them before, hadn't he?
Yeah, they did.
Now
he and the team went out quite often looking for them.
Yeah. Now, some of you may remember that if you ever saw Spook School on TV, he was notable for that with his group, and he was also a regular panel member on Roy Basnett's award-winning radio show Zone Unknown, which aired on City Talk 105.9 FM every Sunday night at 8 till 10, which is now sadly finished. We actually met him when we were invited as panel members on Roy Basnett's show in Liverpool, and as well as the rest of the guys at Power Projects, and was later then invited to join the panel at the annual Paranormal Week at Holton Libraries. Remember that, Steve?
I do indeed.
Stayed in contact with Mark for quite some time after that.
As well as the other guys.
Yeah, and during their time, Mark also co-wrote a book with the rest of these friends at Power Projects called A Beginner's Guide to Paranormal Investigation, and it was published by Ambley. He was neither a believer nor a sceptic, preferring a non-nonsense objective approach to paranormal research and investigation. Now, on the 1st of June 2013, we were invited to share a special day with Mark, and it was the day he married his childhood sweetheart, Michelle, who is a lovely woman, and it was very nice that we obviously met her before the wedding. I'm sure we did. She came over, didn't she, for the show?
Yeah, him and Mark actually joined us on the show.
Her and Mark. He was a regular guest on the KTPF Community Talk Show in the beginning and supported us 100%, saying we should continue as we were doing a good thing. We were planning to have him back on the show, but unfortunately he was busy at the time with his existing project. He was collating information for an up-and-coming book in collaboration with his wife Michelle entitled Secret Liverpool, described as a gazetteer, if that's pronounced right, or a gazetteer, of the lesser-known places and little-forgotten corners of the city, where tantalising clues to the region's past have miraculously survived, often hidden in plain sight among newer structures. This was released on the 15th of August 2015. All seemed to be going fine for Michelle and Mark, until we heard some bad news on Facebook and we wasn't quite sure that it was actually true or not. But in the early hours on the 18th of August, Mark collapsed on his bathroom floor. He had suffered a brain hemorrhage, and sadly a day later he died. He was only 52. Unfortunately, we couldn't make it to his funeral to say goodbye, but he's always in our thoughts, and I'd just like to thank Mark for being such a good friend. So he's always thought about. Every time we do the show, we think of Mark, because, as I said, he was always one to turn around and say that he believed in the KTPF, didn't he, Steve?
He did indeed. He really wanted to keep things friendly with everybody. After all, as he always said, how are you going to learn anything or move forward if you're not sharing information?
Precisely. The paranormal world has really lost a good guy in Mark, as he covered all sorts of investigating genres in this field. And as I say, it is a big loss. I think I'm still affected by it now. I still can't believe he's gone. But, you know, all the best to Michelle for the future. And everyone has been asked to raise their glass to Mark tonight. And I think Michelle said she was out celebrating his birthday tonight. So happy birthday, Mark. You would have been 53 today. So...
Well, I've only got milk, but I'll raise it.
Raise my glass of of water as well.
And an empty cup of coffee, but there we go.
Yeah, he was a good guy, he was, Andy.
Shame I never met him. Really is a shame.
He was one of the few that was, no matter what you wanted to talk about, he was always willing to help.
Oh, yeah. He's been on talking about UFOs, he's been on talking about ghosts, you know, all sorts of things.
Him and Michelle came on and talked about vampires.
Yeah, yeah, even some artifacts as well. So, but yeah, it is a big loss, not only for Michelle, but for the paranormal world and his friends, so we'll always remember him. And I just wanted to use that as my two penneth tonight, considering it was his birthday.
That's fair enough, absolutely. I say, that was the guy who had the interview of at the end of the show, we did the third anniversary show, that was him.
Yes.
Remember, yeah. Oh, okay, yeah, it's a shame. Some, one of those people just love to have met, but maybe one day, you know, in the big ghost hunt in the sky, as they say, perhaps we'll meet then. But yeah, it definitely would have been a shame to have, it's a shame to have lost him.
Yeah, as I say, he was all planning to come on the show as well, but obviously at the time he was collaborating with Michelle with this book that he was doing, apart from other projects that he had going on. And he was talking about actually coming out of, you know, of the paranormal, and after 20 odd years he was in it, and he was actually thinking about dropping it, and so maybe in some way. You know what they say, sometimes people know what's going to happen.
Well,
inadvertently, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so he's kind of preserved within the field, you know, he's a name that we know and mentioned.
Precisely. You know, I think he'll always be remembered when it comes to the paranormal, especially for people in the north, you know, in the northwest and that.
Yes, I certainly don't know him so well, but yes, definitely he's a definitely important figure in the field, just to... They've been so enthusiastic. As you say, it's nice to see such positivity and such a wide range of topics. I mean, I like to think I cover quite a few things here, but, you know, that's a broader terms, collection of topics even I would even talk about. So, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, so as I say, Mark Rosny, always remembered. Rest in peace, my mate. And
we'll see you again someday.
See him again someday, yeah. Yeah, definitely. So that was me. So,
our guest
will be on in a couple of minutes. She has come online ready, so which is good. So I'll just see if she's ready now.
I'm sure she'll be ready. Oh, what do you do?
I put it in the wrong place. I'm searching for OK to start.
Flustered yourself.
Oh dear, I am. I think that got me a little bit, to be honest with you. So, mind you, I think at the end of the day, I prefer to remember Mark as he was. Come back and tell me if you're ready. So, as I say, Heidi is the woman that actually named the Hat Man. She gave them their distinctive names. So we're going to find out more about this. And about shadow people and about her experiences as well. So hopefully she'll tell us about her personal story.
That would be the most interesting thing, how she experienced it herself. It's all very well sort of sitting and talking and writing about such things from an armchair, but if you experience it yourself, that gives you a whole new perspective.
Yes.
I remember Steve's story a while back about seeing that shadow figure between two buses, I think it was, on a ghost investigation some time ago.
Yeah.
I mean, I've potentially seen such things. Woodchester Mansion is the place that always springs to mind for dark, shadowy figures, which you might say were conventionally, well, it seems funny to say we'd say conventional ghosts, but you might have said was a ghost rather than anything else.
Right, okay.
I don't think mine would like me saying hello to it.
Right. We're going to get Heidi on now, so we're going to add her to the group. Hopefully that works. If not, I'm going to have to do it the other way. Oh, here we go. That worked perfectly.
Yeah.
Hi there.
Hi, Heidi.
Hey, how's it going?
Not too bad. Welcome to the KTPF Community Talk Show.
Wonderful. It's awesome to be here.
First of all, can you tell us a bit about yourself and how you got involved in all this paranormal business?
Oh, gosh. Sure. I started off as someone that had experienced odd things as a kid growing up in a haunted house. I think a lot of researchers start off from having a personal experience, and boy, I suffered. So, I went from that to having some very, very scary dreams that happened to be a shared experience among myself and my siblings, and tiptoed from that to seeing odd lights in the sky, having a memory come back with my other sister and I of essentially coming across, this is scary, a robotic toy clown when we were kids that caused us great horror and fear, and it like levitated off the ground, and we both passed out, lost consciousness, didn't remember it till 10 years later.
Wow.
And just crazy stuff. And then, I got my interest going with I'd seen a really, really, really large UFO. I'm from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, over here in the States, and saw a really large UFO and thought, gosh, it would be really cool to talk to other people who have experienced odd things. And I joined a group of people who happened to be alien abductees. Mm. And I was the only one who had just seen a UFO. And I soon was... there's a phenomenon of black, unmarked helicopters over here, like harassing people that say they've seen, you know, aliens, UFOs, and whatnot. And soon after joining that group, I had that experience. And then soon after that, I got visitors. I guess the best way to describe them were like gray alien beings who invaded my apartment, and went from that to seeing shadow people, and the Hat Man phenomenon came my way. So just crazy. I mean, I feel like a paranormal magnet, but I've found that people who have experienced one phenomenon tend to experience others. So I don't think I'm so odd or strange anymore.
Right, okay. So you say you've had an encounter with yourself with shadow people. Before we go into that, do you feel that shadow people, the shadow people phenomena, although it seems fairly widespread, do you think that they are related to the ghost and haunting phenomena?
Yeah, you know, it's strange to say, but I believe that definitely there's a direct connection with shadow people and haunted areas, and as well as some alien beings. It's an odd thing, but there's a connection. When it comes to shadow people, you know, 9 times out of 10, if somebody goes in to research a haunted area, I am certain they're going to come across a shadow person at some point, and they generally tend to. Mm. In the beginning, you know, when I was putting word out about these shadow people, and people were thinking I was nuts, you know, like, what is this girl talking about? That's science fiction. And then some paranormal investigators would get in touch with me and say, you know, shadow people are nothing but the shadow of a ghost. And I'm like, wait till you meet one. they are nothing human, you know, and slowly but surely, you know, I started hearing back from these same researchers and other ones going, oh my gosh, that gives you a different feeling. You know, it's a strange thing to say, but when you're standing in front of a shadow person, it gives you such a feeling of horror and terror. Yeah, there's some people that don't have that fear reaction.
Yeah.
And, you know, but then, you know, there's some people that are afraid of dogs and others who are not. So, you know, to each their own. Who knows why some people, you know, have no reaction, but most people tend to have a fear reaction when seeing one of these things.
So when we talk about shadow people and the Hat Man, are they the same kind of entity?
No, they're not. Unfortunately, when I first started talking about shadow people, I'd placed some different drawings up on my website, and I just kind of dubbed them different names, and I put Shadow Streak, Shadow Cloud, Shadow Cat, Shadow Head and Shoulder Shadow, and it's a big, hulking, almost looks like a man, but not quite, big, giant, shadowy thing that it looks like it has no neck, looks like just a strange looking thing, and sometimes they have red eyes. And I placed up one that I called the Hat Man Shadow. Unfortunately, I had not experienced the Hat Man myself, so I'll tell you a little bit about that story. Okay, so the shadow people, they had invaded my apartment that I shared with a college roommate, and we were just, you know, we're absolutely just terrorized and terrified, I mean, on a consistent basis. And my college roommate, her name was Samantha, would shriek in the middle of the night, you know, about different things, and I used to go barreling and running, like, oh my god, what's going on? And it's just like, oh, just another one of those things, you know, it's okay, I'm good. And so I got used to her screaming. And it's so strange, it's so odd, but I got used to her screaming. And but this one night she shrieked, and she screamed again, and she screamed. I'm like, oh my god, somebody's killing her. I mean, it was like a death scream unlike anything I'd ever heard. I went barreling, running, you know, just, you know, shove the door open, like expecting to see that she is, you know, being slaughtered. And she was in the corner of her room, balled up as small as she could, pointing at me, you know, going, the man. I'm like, what man? And I'm like, oh my god, you know, somebody broke in. You know, I'm thinking, she had a door that led out to our front porch. And so I'm assuming somebody came in. And she's like, no. And I'm like literally looking around trying to, you know, find where'd this man go. And she could barely catch her breath when she finally told me, he disappeared when you opened the door. And I'm like, what? You know, a man? And she went on to describe in great detail. And she's a great artist. So she did a lot of the graphics and whatnot and drawings that you see on my sites. She described this man in a three-piece suit, black suit, and he had a long trench coat, a flat gaucho hat, and he had a goatee. And she described him having solid black eyes and even a chained watch on his hip. And I'm like, you know, but he was very, very dark, and he kind of blended in with the shadows, but she spoke of him being very, very real. And I'm like, wow, this must be another form these shadow people take, you know, because they sure are able to shapeshift into different things. So, you know, she and I were, you know, pretty consistent in saying, well, I guess so, you know, and put that on the website. Now, so I'm going out and I'm talking about shadow people, and I'm saying, and this is another form the shadow people take. And soon after putting this drawing that she put up, that she drew up on my website, I started to see a pattern, and I didn't like what I was seeing in regards to the Hat Man, and people were really giving different scenarios than what the shadow people were doing. Shadow people, they'll come at you, and you know, they'll creep around. Shadow spiders, oh gosh, those are the ones that I had the most dealings with. Those will creep around and you know, they'll scare you, they'll come at you, but oftentimes when you spot them, they'll run off. But their favorite pastime thing to do is when you're sleeping, they like to choke you, so get you when you're down type of thing. The Hat Man, people were describing very, very real features. Mm. Very, very solid man that would come in and not just pay a visit, but follow people for years. For years. He'd hide in the bushes. He'd be in the trees. He'd come out of their closet. He'd sit on their bed. He would talk. And I'm like, what is going on here? I did not like the pattern that was going on. And I sat on it for a while. And, you know, I just kept kind of going forward, shadow people. And I'm like, well, this man is not a shadow person. And the revelations that people were revealing, gosh, I mean, they would ask me, who is he? And they would almost always answer their own question. He's a devil, isn't he? He is. He's the demon. And, you know, I left it open to people to interpret for themselves. And everything kind of points in the direction of being the demon of all demons.
Hmm.
But who's to say 100%? Because dark things are liars too, so I don't know, you know, but he is an orchestrator of a lot of negativity.
So what is he doing?
You know, he will be seen with shadow people, just so you know, too. He will be seen with them.
Sounds like he's a stalker.
Oh, he's, I call him the pervert of the dark world. He loves to go after kitties, too. He's disgusting. And you know what? These shadow people and the Hat Man can be very, very sexual, raping people as well. This is not a topic that people tend to like to discuss, but it does come up. But, you know, a lot of people are really reluctant to talk about that element. You know, it's interesting. So the shadow people, just to back up a little bit, the shadow people, they'll give you a really a strange feeling of them being nosy, hanging, lingering, you know, like, what the heck, what do they want, what are they doing? Hat Man makes you fear for your life, your soul, with just a glance. And the things, okay, so shadow people might growl, they may whisper something, sometimes people have told me that they speak in a guttural voice, but that's more rare. Hat Man, if he feels so inclined, he will definitely share a little bit about you and what he would like to do with you, your soul. I'll give you an example of one of the earlier stories that were sent to me. This young guy had become a drug addict, and for some reason, and he accidentally overdosed, and came to in the hospital bed, he found himself tied down, of course, so he wouldn't hurt himself, and he had a visitor. It was the Hat Man. He turned, he looked at this guy, the guy turned and looked at him, stood up, hung over him, got within an inch of his face, and put his hand up to make like a pinching motion, and said, "I was this close to having you." And then he disappeared. he is a bastard of all bastards.
That sounds more like the Grim Reaper.
He does sound like that, but then there is a Grim Reaper type out there as well. And he has also been seen alongside of the Hat Man. Verdict is still out on him and what to think about what this Grim Reaper type creature is up to. Wow, the stories that I've been getting about that guy, it's almost like a minion of the Hat Man. So no. I'm not certain. But the Hat Man, he likes to taunt people. He likes to threaten people. He likes to tell them what to do. I had one person that told me. this is a funny story. You guys know Nightmare on Elm Street, the movie, correct?
Yeah.
And Freddy Krueger, I mean, my gosh, if that's not the Hat Man, I don't know who is. So this guy, he's an adult now, but he said when he was a kid, he and his brother had bunk beds. And his brother slept on the bottom, he slept on the top. And he said for about a week, he would watch his closet door open up, and this guy come out of the closet. And he did not have a hat. He had a three-piece suit on. And he kept reaching for something. And the guy would scream, and he'd go back into the closet. Well, the one night, he was successful in grabbing what it was he was after, and he disappeared with it. And it was his brother's cherished Freddy Krueger hat.
Oh, I don't know.
I'm like, is that where the Hat Man got it from? Truly, it was his brother's Freddy Krueger hat. Just the strangest thing. He likes to taunt little kids. I don't know what it is to like break them down when they're young. But I've had people recall when they're, you know, in baby cribs, and the Hat Man coming. Now, I don't have that good of a memory. I don't know how people recall such things. But they're like, I had to be about 2 years old because I was still in one of those baby-like beds. And I'm like, what? And they're like, the terror. This is an interesting story. Hat Man came to this guy while he was still in a crib of a sort. And he said he thinks he was about two and a half when the Hat Man came and lifted him, and he started to scream. Now, what's interesting is he said, I got the distinct impression from him, if I said, screamed one more time, he was going to kill me. What kind of power does this thing have that it can instill that in a child so young? So he stopped screaming, but his mother heard him, and the mother came to the door, and she saw the Hat Man had him. She started to come in, and the door slammed on her. And she heard her son, as a child, screaming like a grown man. The things she said that she heard coming from him, it gives me chills, coming from him. And she was fighting the whole time to get into the door. When she finally got in, he wasn't in the crib anymore. The room was tore up. And she found him underneath a bunch of stuff underneath the bed. And when the door opened, it knocked the door off the hinges. It opened with such force. It was just the craziest stories.
Right. Well, we've got a question in the chat room for you from Della. She said, has Heidi ever heard of Mr. Gonswell incidents? Mr. Gonswell, if that's pronounced right, was a fedora hat man, but he was in his shape-shifting way revealed by himself to be connected to the ancient native spirits in the Bronx area. He did not intend to frighten the young witnesses. His parting words were to the young boy, I only wanted to be your friend. Have you heard that one?
I have not heard of this one, interesting enough, the Native Americans over here have experienced a similar type entity, and they give them different names. Mm. I believe one of them that's the most popular is Walking Sam. I believe that's what they call him. And he does very much the same thing. I mean, he likes to befriend kids. He likes to have them, you know, let their guard down, but he also terrorizes them.
Yeah.
So I think people give different names to the same entity. I believe the imaginative and fictional character of Slender Man is, you know, truly the Hat Man. Mm. I mean, he does the same things. He can shapeshift. He tells kids to go do this or do that. Yeah. Now, there was an interesting thing that happened here 2 weeks after I put out my book on the Hat Man and 2014. I don't know if you heard about the two 12-year-old girls who attacked their other 12-year-old friend, stabbed her, I don't know how many times, over 20 times or something, because they assume Slender Man told them to do it in their dreams. And this is 2 weeks after I published the book on the Hat Man, and this happened within a 10-minute drive of my childhood home where my family still lives. To me, the timing was off the charts of sending a message, because just before, now I had not all this while had not seen the Hat Man. He's been behind me. People have screamed and, whoa, who's that? You know, that type of thing. I've not seen him. He's not come at me. He's not anything.
Mm.
And in the end stage of writing that book, he came my way. And then 2 weeks after putting this book out, these 12-year-olds go attacking in the woods, you know, so close to my family home. Just really disturbing. Yeah. Really disturbing patterns.
Now, there has been a theory that shadow people are parallel dimensional beings who were first recorded by indigenous people in 1153 BC, and apparently between 1980 through to 2000 and beginning in 2001, there was an awakening, and the quickening began, in which events and time seems to be speeding up, helping shadow people to become visible as frequencies rises. Did you find that there was more frequency in them times, or do you feel as though it's all the time anyway?
You know, I know that they've been around since the beginning of time. I believe these are the beings that are spoken of in biblical times, of something that could take on different forms, you know? I do notice the increase in their activity, and I have to guess that, you know, their time is running short. The veil is thinning, and this is why they do not like when people can spot them. You know, oftentimes I've heard and seen, even, you know, my first shadow person encounter, it's like, because I saw it, it came at me, it tried to get me, you know. And a lot of people that have experienced these things, you know, they saw it in passing, and then, oh, it came at them. If you can see your enemy coming, you could defend yourself, you could warn others. They do not like that. Definitely increase. As I mentioned, I started off with an interest in ghosts, and then the alien topic. And then it stretched over into the topic of shadow people and holy encounters as well, Jesus encounters, and the Hat Man. Now, my website, I used to get flooded with all these alien stories. Aliens, aliens, aliens. Mm. I put up shadow people drawings. Boom. Alien topics almost drop 100%, all shadow people stories. I put up the Hat Man image, the one Hat Man image versus all these shadow people images. And still to this day, about 90% of my emails are Hat Man. So it's as if the guy that's in charge of these other shadow people, he's becoming a lot more prominent. And I tell people, you know, the chances that shadow people may come to you is just not a possibility. It's a threat. Mm. And it's time that people realize and wake up to the facts that something's going on, whether they want to acknowledge it or not. You know, I called my first book The Secret War. That's based on the shadow people. And I wrote this in 97. I'd never heard anybody utter the word shadow people before I wrote this. And it took 4 years. All these publishers say they would publish it, and they didn't. It just, I spread it around other researchers and whatnot during this time, and finally got it published in 01. But a lot, the second that I came forward and mentioned this word, I've been flooded ever since with just thousands of stories from all over the globe. I don't know where I haven't received a story about shadow people, and now Hat Man. I mean, my God, you know, I call this a secret war because it's already happening. You know, people think there's going to be a big battle in the sky between angels and demons. I'm like, why don't you lean in closer to what your friend is discussing that happened to them in the middle of the night that you're laughing about? Mm. You know?
Yeah.
That they're battling for their souls. People are dying in their sleep. What? These are young, healthy people. Mm. What's going on in their sleep? You know? And I think that it's sad that people get so ridiculed, and to the point that they don't feel they can turn to the person closest to them. They have to contact somebody like myself on the opposite side of the globe to vent. I mean, we're literally doing an injustice to our friends and family that we don't have an open enough mind to hear them out. And they're suffering. These people are becoming alcoholics, drug addicts, insomniacs, suicidal, depressed, and tortured. Imagine every night seeing something out of a movie come for you. And people laugh. I'm like, wow, you know, keep on laughing because it's going to happen to, you know, eventually. I truly believe it's going to happen to more people than not.
Okay. Steve's got a question for you.
Hi, yeah. Heidi.
Hey there.
Yeah. Why do we always assume that things like the shadow people are evil just because they're dark and they're like a dark entity? I mean, I've heard stories, and obviously when we looked up on this subject, we listened to other interviews, people were emailing in that not all these shadow people attack people. Sometimes they just sit on the bed and talk to you, and they're not aggressive at all.
Yeah, I've gotten probably like 0.05% of my emails that I get, I get stories like that. People saying, well, my Hat Man's not evil, or my shadow people don't hurt me. Mm. And I'm like, well, you know what? there's a lot of people that have a lot of different interpretations.
Yeah.
And good for you if you're not afraid. But you know what? I think it's a healthy amount of fear that people have. And, you know, some of the people, I don't know, sometimes it seems ego that says, well, I wasn't afraid. They can't all be evil, you know, just because it looks like this or feels like that. Yeah, he slapped me once, but he's okay now. It's like, what? Hold on, back up. He slapped you once. He choked you once. But now he's okay, and he's smiling. Oh, good for you. It reminds me kind of the alien abduction phenomenon. I was around when people were absolutely terrified. You know, oh, my God, they're raping me. They're raping my kids, and I hate them. They're demonic, and da-da-da-da-da. And then all of a sudden, Stockholm Syndrome kicked in, it seemed like, and they suddenly had an affinity for them. Well, I'm chosen. Mm. I'm special. They came to me because they need me, you know, and I was stunned. I'm like, well, hold on. These are the same people that raped you or beings that did this to you. And yeah, but it's okay now. I've learned to accept that I'm just different. And I kind of see this going on with the shadow people. You know, well, it doesn't scare me anymore. I got used to it. Oh, you got used to it, you know, or I saw it in passing. It didn't scare me, mm-hmm. you know, and I just, you know, that's great that you can, you know, hold up your legs underneath your body while most of us would faint. I've seen a lot of them, and they still scare me. Yeah. I don't run. I don't hide. I don't scream. No. Does that mean that they're not scary? Well, yes, they are. But to say they're demonic, these things, I mean, look at 99% of the stories out there.
Yeah.
They're horrible. They're absolutely horrible. And, you know, to like, take a tiger as a pet, you know, it's going to bite you at some yeah. point.
Now,
you know?
How do you feel about the skeptics who say that shadow people are the result of an old overactive imagination, sleep paralysis, nocturnal death syndrome? What would you say to them?
You know, I don't even know why they're so adamant in trying to disprove. You know, it never hurts me to hear what others believe to be true for themselves. I don't know why it hurts a skeptic so bad that they have to go out of their way to try to poo-poo what others know to be true for themselves. I think that's the case of a very small-minded and sad person, honestly. But the skeptics, they'll exist for, you know, anything and everything. It doesn't seem to matter. But, you know, I say if a person's word could be taken in the court of law and put another person behind bars for the rest of their lives over here in the States anyhow, you know, I would say take the word of these people who are not making a dime off from telling their story, you know? And it's like so many people, it's so interesting to me, you know? I hear, oh, well, you're making a living off from this, so that's why you're hyping this up. I'm like, no, I'm a therapist. I still practice. I only know a handful of those who research these odd topics that make a living off from it.
Yeah.
We did this out of pure passion. This is something I'm doing it because I can't sit idly by and watch others suffer if I know that I could be of help in some form. These things are taking souls. They're torturing kids. Mm. I mean, for crying out loud, you know, realize that, you know, those that do this stuff are, you know, this is blood, sweat, and tears and just sheer will that gets us through to the next day in hopes of shining a light on every corner in this dark world.
Okay, so we've spoke about the Hat Man and shadow people. Do we know who the hooded figure is?
You know, this guy, oh my gosh, he's very different. He's very different in what he does, and some of the stories that I've heard would really just spin your head. I'll tell you a story. Okay, so I had a friend who was just driving in broad daylight from between states over here, and pretty long stretch of freeway, and he just got like this crazy feeling over him that something was wrong ahead. And in the divider, there's grass and trees, but in this area there was nothing but grass, and he said, Heidi, I saw a very tall, I want to say he told me about 10 foot tall, Grim Reaper looking guy with a sickle and all, walking full force so fast. And he said, I turned my head, I looked, I'm like, what is that thing? And he just got the message in his head, he's going towards the church. He's like, I didn't even know there was a church ahead. He said, and I'm looking as good, much as I can before I'm, you know, running off the road. And about a mile down, there was a church. He said, oh, my God, what was that? I'm like, you know, his presence and what he's doing is still kind of out there. I've heard people go to places, be drugged to places where he's at, soul-wise, and like made to almost try to bow to him. I don't know who he is. I don't know what he's quite doing. He looks like the Grim Reaper for a reason. So something is up. I truly don't know. I'm trying to get a better grasp on the majority of the stories. He's showing up more often. He's not as big of a deal right now as the Hat Man is.
Okay.
And I think people need to be really, truly leery about Shadow People and the Hat Man. If they see the Hat Man, you know, people, you know, this is another big passion of mine. It's like I balance between two different arenas, I guess you could say, the light and the dark. And, you know, people are like, well, how do you do that? You know, it's like I was somebody who experienced, you know, the ghosts. And I had some psychic phenomenon that came my way. And myself and one of my sisters, you know, we were confused. We were both experiencing a lot of these things together. And we went to our church and we asked, you know, what of people, like, you know, who could see the future and see things. And one of the pastors told us, well, only God knows the future and only the devil would tell it. So that would mean that person is evil. I'm like, boom, you know, I just lost my interest. You know, it's like, I was done. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm not evil. You know, something is going on. I'm seeing things. I'm aware of things. And, so I'd steered away from the church. I kept my faith in God. I thought Jesus was a historical figure that did a lot of cool things. But, you know, I started looking more towards the stars and, you know, looking in that direction. You know, having had the experiences that I had with the Shadow People and then a positive alien encounter being that essentially steered me and my college roommate in a direction that told me I needed to get back to my roots and my faith. And, you know, that's easier said than done. But I've had to go full circle back to my faith. And thank God I did, because with the onslaught of this madness that I've been dealing with for years now, there's no way I'd be able to speak to you sanely, be able to stand on my own two feet. Because, you know, I tell people, you know, they're like, well, what do we do? How do we get rid of these things? I'm like, well, if you don't have, you're looking at something that is the epitome of evil. You feel it, you see it. Mm. And you're like, oh, but I don't have any, I don't believe in that church stuff. I'm like, well, you don't believe in that church stuff? Well, then you might as well get the biggest shoe in the house and throw it at it. Because if you don't have something behind you that can go against this negativity, you are alone in this battle. You need to get back to your faith, whatever it is. And because that is the only thing that really, truly will fight for you.
Okay. Now, just quickly before I go on to this next question from Della again, you mentioned therapy. What kind of therapy do you do?
I'm an occupational therapist, and I work with a big range from children to those with psychological issues and trying to help people become more independent emotionally, mentally, physically. So I also work with the upper body strengthening. A physical therapist works with strength. I work with strength and everything else. But okay, we have a lot of arenas that we could work in. So if you have an injury or, you know, emotional distress, psychological disorder, I mean, we work on a lot of different things.
Okay. Right, Della's asking, now she's a practicing psychic, and she's asking, do you confront shadow people with your higher self or as a regular person? She's not sure whether you're actually reading them as a psychic or whether you're just a regular person that's seeing them.
Hmm. You know, I always say I'm too ordinary to be tagged as being something that, like a medium, though I get thrown different different titles, but I think there's probably a multi-layer of things that help protect me and confront these things, because in the beginning, I didn't know what I was dealing with. My place was overridden with shadow people, and I would see these balls of light come in from outside and attack them. I've seen thin strings of light that would go over me almost like a spider web looking thing and keep these things away. I didn't know what I was seeing. I didn't know what I was experiencing. But I've also seen a lot of ghosts unexpectedly, didn't appreciate it very much. I just don't like ghosts. I think it's the childhood thing. I just didn't appreciate seeing them. Mm. But this is a strange thing. So when I'm asleep and these things have come at me, negative things, something wakes me up. I don't know what it is, but I'm wide awake and immediately I'm able to react, respond, and repel it. After this took some time. I didn't know what was going on in the beginning with the lights and whatnot, but I always did wake up when they would come around, but something was helping to defend me. I didn't know what it was. But then I learned to defend myself. And for me, it's like throwing a brick wall out of my chest with God written all over it, and prayers, you know. I don't know what it is exactly, but like even in the presence of one time my apartment was just, it's strange. I'm not an alien abductee, but they sure did come into my apartment one time, and I was not paralyzed, and I got up and I confronted them like, what's going on here? And they freaked out, and I'm like, I don't get paralyzed. I don't freeze. I can't say it hasn't happened a couple times, but I've always broken free of it. I don't know exactly what it is, but I'll tell you, I just found out 4 years ago that I have like 12 really rare malformations that it's not common at all. And one being how can I say, the C1, C2, my spine is not connected fully. My vertebrae is not connected. And it's a strange thing to say. There's no bone really holding my head upon my shoulders. So I don't know if that's something that makes me a little bit different than the next person, to be able to handle some of the things that I do, that some of the things that I see. I don't go around looking to see things. I think I see enough. And in more recent years, I have just, I've asked to close that off. I don't like, the last one was a headless woman that was really, I was just done. I just really was like, no, thank you. And, but I still see, you know, enough where I'm like, okay, I got you. But I just don't care to look at these things as much.
Steve, you got a question?
Yeah. A lot of the Native American councils, including the High Council of the Twisted Hair, believe that shadow people actually feed on our negativity. So hence us being scared of them actually feeds them and makes them stronger. Because a lot of the problem of us being scared of these things is because religion and Hollywood tells us we should be.
They do feed off on the negativity. Oftentimes people have written and told me, you know, this thing was choking me and I gave up. I'm like, I'm going to die. And they let that fight go. And the shadow person let him go. Like, well, this isn't fun anymore. I think they must hang out in theme parks a lot, you know, people are screaming and, terror is something that, I think is a natural response to something out of the ordinary that we're not used to seeing. I mean, I'd never seen one of these things before. I was terrified when I'd seen it. And it's so far out there when you're experiencing them. It's just like when you see a UFO. I'm more fascinated when I've seen UFOs, though. But a lot of people, I've known people disappear for days because they've seen a UFO and it changed their reality so much they didn't know how to categorize it. So I think it's a natural reaction to have the fear and the terror that people do. It's fight or flight. And I've had people, oh my gosh, people that go swinging at these shadow people, they regret it because they'll hit you back. And they feed off from that anger as well. I could tell you my first experience, what happened, if you'd like, with the shadow person.
Yeah, definitely.
So I was living in another state in Iowa, and I was staying at a friend's house and their family's home on the second floor. It was an attic. The attic was not complete, but at the end there was a bedroom. And so the center part of the attic was just empty and dark. No lights coming in there, nothing. And so this day, she and I went to go to her uncle's home. It was broad daylight out, and we're walking along, and she's talking away, and I thought I saw something in my peripheral vision, and I turn, and I look, I'm like, what on earth did I just see? You know, I see this black mass ducked behind a tree, and I'm like, I didn't know what was going on. She's still carrying on, talking, walking, and I watch this black mass duck behind trees, bushes, and follow us all the way to her uncle's home. I was so freaked out, I did not say a word to my friend. And we stayed there for a short while at our uncle's, and we turned to come back home. And this thing followed us all the way back. And I watched this thing doing this, and I got a good, decent look at it. And by the time we reached her home, I was just like beside myself. I said, I don't know what I'm seeing here, but I just saw this. And I grabbed a piece of paper and a pen, and I drew what I call the head and shoulder shadow, which is like a kind of looks like a hulking man with its head directly connected to its shoulders. Mm. No neck to be seen.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking she's going to look at this drawing and start laughing. And I'm like, well, this is what I saw. And she's like, she looks at the drawing and goes, oh, him. Yeah, I don't know who he is. I'm like, what? Are you serious? Yeah, I don't know. He's been following me for years. And she's like, hey, Dad, look, Heidi saw him too. And he comes over and looks at the drawing. And is like, oh, is he back? I'm just like, what is going on here? You know, I just can't believe I witnessed this. And you guys are confirming he's real. And it was just crazy. So soon after that, I needed to get something from that room up in that attic. And it's still broad, you know, daylight out. And I went upstairs. I didn't have to turn the lights on because there was light coming from that bedroom through that central attic room. I get into my room, grab what I needed to, spun around to leave. And that big black shadow was just standing there, blocking my way to get out of the room. I don't even know how to describe that type of terror. Mm. I mean, I felt, and it's a strange thing to say, but my cells, everything felt, this thing wants to kill me. And it was leaning over me, and I was leaning back. And I knew somehow if I ran, it was going to get me. If I swung at this thing, it was going to get me. And I'm like, if I stay here, I am going to die, though, too. I have to get out of here. But he's blocking my way. So I don't know why or how. I kind of closed my eyes and started saying a prayer and walked straight through him. Slowly, methodically. And I mean, this thing was breathing down my neck, following me all the way through that big black empty part of the attic. I got to the top of the stairs, and it was like I couldn't function, and my legs collapsed underneath me, and I fumbled all the way down the stairs. And my friend heard me falling. She comes to the door, opens it, and I just kind of roll out, and she's like, what happened? And I'm like, I just had no air. I'm like, he's upstairs, you know. And it was a horrifying thing, but the lesson, I didn't know I needed to know this lesson, not to run, not to swing at it. So I felt almost as if whispered to not do these things and what to do, and got out of that situation. And, you know, for the longest time, I didn't realize and didn't acknowledge the connection to my years after that and dealing with this other nightmare that came to me. I started having what I thought were just nightmares of giant black shadowy spiders coming at me. Just horrifying. I would be waking up, shrieking, looking for anything to hit the spider. It's one thing to dream about it, and then to wake up and to see them there. Sometimes there were just multitudes of shadowy little spiders all over me. Just horrifying. I hate spiders.
Me too. You're going to give me nightmares tonight now. You wanted to carry on there, Steve.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of agree about the negativity. I mean, the guys on the show have heard me say this before, but I've actually seen a shadow person myself. I was setting up for an investigation and a bus depot, and I looked down the length of the buses, probably three buses away, about 50 metres, and there's this two-dimensional shape of a man looking at me. And I just looked up and went, hello, and it went. It's just gone.
Disappeared.
Just gone.
Wow.
So, one question we need to ask, that Andy's asked me to ask you, is how often do you encounter these shadows and Hat Man and stuff? Is it on a daily basis, weekly basis?
Oh my gosh, it used to be on a daily basis until I learned how to keep them away. I don't have to deal with them anymore. And I swear I'm like a bloodhound in my home. they're not allowed here, but I'll tell you this, I'll get passerbys and I'll watch them. And I'm like, just keep on moving, buddy. Just keep on going. I'll watch them come through. But, the interesting thing I'd mentioned, with the Hat Man. So I had just completed essentially, the Hat Man book.
Yeah.
And my home was clear of anything being negative or being allowed into my place. And, but you know, here I'm writing about this freak. So he apparently got a little ticked. And, you know, whenever I tick off something from the ether worlds, I know I'm on the right path. I take it as a compliment. I'm like, oh, here we go, everybody. So, so this one night I'm laying in bed. And I don't know what it is that wakes me up. And I'm like, oh, he's here.
Yeah.
And I knew he was looking at me, and I knew he was angry. And I guess, you know, and again, I have not seen him. I refuse to look at this man. And he came, he was standing in just outside of my bedroom doors, the French doors. And I'm like, really? So you've come, I'm thinking to myself. And, you know, they say curiosity killed the cat. I was curious, okay, because he has not come at me ever, and he's not shown his face ever. I don't welcome him either. So, and I'm like, well, are we going to have a little standoff? You know, what's going on? I kept my eyes closed. I kept laying there, and I waited to see what he was going to do. And he stood there for a couple minutes, and then he took one step in. I heard his shoes coming in, click, click. And like, really? You're going to be bold enough to come into my room, are you? And he took another step. And I'm like, and I was curious. And, you know, again, they always say, do not welcome darkness. But I didn't put a do not disturb sign on the door either. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, because I was curious. And I'm like, let's see what this freak's going to try to pull here. And he walks in, and he stands to the side of my bed. And I'm like, I know he wanted me to give him some respectful fear and looking at him. And I wasn't going to give him that pleasure, so I didn't look at him. And then he sat on my bed. And I'm like, really? You know, he's just totally antagonizing me. And I'm sitting there just like, you know, I still just very aware, just, you know, waiting to see what he's going to pull. And then it's as if, you know, he let me know I've got all night. And he stretched out across the bottom of my bed. And I felt him prop his head up on his elbow. And I'm like, oh, okay, buddy, you are not staying here all night. I need to sleep. And my go-to to get rid of anything that's wrong, I'll just, you know, even say in the name of Jesus to get rid of something. Well, apparently I waited too long. I went to go speak, and it felt like I had a mouthful of peanut butter. I'm like, oh no. Whoops, Heidi, you got too curious. But I got the name out, and poof, he was gone. And then I sat up, and I saw where he had laid, you know, and everything. I'm like, wow, you freak, he came in like that. And, you know, so that, he came in, but that was me kind of, I let my guard a little bit down for that. But I'll tell you, this is, he let me know in another way that was so in my face, you know. If ever a person questions, you know, well, maybe I was dreaming that, you know. This happened soon after that, and this one takes the cake. So I practice as an occupational therapist. I work with physical therapists and speech therapists or pathologists. I think you call them kinesiologists? What do you guys call them over there? Physiatrists, you call them. I work with these different therapists, and I went to this building that I don't generally go to, and these therapists, there are two physical therapists there, and they're like, knowing, oh, it's that girl that does that paranormal stuff, and they're like, so, Heidi, you write books? I'm like, yeah. Really? I'm like, what, on what? You know, and probably for about 15 minutes, I told these other two therapists what it is that I write on, and I spoke about the Jesus is No Joke book, and Jesus Encounters, and Shadow People, and the Hat Man. And they were like, ooh, that's some creepy stuff, you know? And one of the therapists had to leave. It was later in the evening. I was doing my notes in the office, and the other therapist had to see another patient yet. And the physical therapists work within parallel bars to help patients stand up and whatnot. So she's out there, and the parallel bars are surrounded by mirrors from the floor to the ceiling. And I'm doing my notes in the other room when I hear her scream. You know, I'm like, what on earth? She's like, and she runs back into the office where I'm at, and she's barely making any sense. She's like, just come out here. I'm like, what? You know, what's going on? And she's like, the guy you're talking about. I'm like, I don't know what you're speaking of. We go out there. She has a patient within the parallel bars that is trying, you know, he's trying to stand up, and he's an older guy. He was forgetful, but he wasn't demented. And he goes, who is this man in this suit trying to talk to me in another language? And I said, what? I said, sir, what are you speaking of? He's like, the man in the black suit, and he's pointing at the mirror. He's trying to tell me something. He's like, hold on, what? What do you say? And I'm like, oh, my God. And we don't see anything, of course. And I'm like, well, what's he saying? He's like, I don't know. I don't know what language that is he's saying to us. And I'm like, sir, turn around. Do you see him behind us? He turns and looks. He's like, what? He's like, what are you guys trying to pull on me? And he goes, oh, and he looks back at the mirror. He goes, there he is. And then he goes to the other therapist. He's behind you now. She screams. And I was like, just to make certain, I asked him. I said, sir, does he have a hat on? He's like, yes, he has a hat on. I knew you could see him. I was like, oh, my God. We just got done speaking about him, and he showed up. That is how close and how quick he can respond. And the story goes on from there. I actually put it closer to the end of the Hat Man book that I have out now, what happened, because it was a two-day event of him showing up. Okay. Unbelievable stuff. Just crazy.
Della's asking, the presence of hooded figures unrelated to monastery remains has been linked to Roman god forms. Have you looked into this in European encounters?
You know, I have heard of that. I've not looked heavily into this Grim Reaper type of hooded figure just yet. I'm working on a new Shadow People book right now. I'm a cartoonist as well, and I'm making a book series that is based on the stuff that I write on in general. I'm going to even do Shadow People. Perhaps a Hat Man, we'll see. So, and if you go to ficklefinders.com, that that'll be the book series. And you know, that it's a topic that truly, truly intrigues me. People who want me to look into the black-eyed kid phenomenon as well. So there's a couple of topics that I may look into at some point. Truly just overwhelming what's going on out there. But Hatman is really ticking me off. He is doing so many things that people really need to be weary and aware. His activity is increasing. But the interesting part, and people need to know this, Jesus encounters are on the rise too. So what's going on here? Are they showing up to those that are on their side of the fence? I've had people, and I had good friends who have seen both Jesus and Hatman, not together, of course, but, you know, it's a time for people to declare where they stand in their faith. I have a couple of books, one that I'm going to be putting out soon, called The Other F Word. So theotherfword.com, meaning for your faith. And I'm really casual in the way that I write things, and it ticks some people off. Like, why does she laugh? Why does she have a good time with the paranormal? Well, I'm a cartoonist at heart, and I like humor. And I write my books as light as I can. Hatman is a horrific topic. I wrote it as light and as inspiring as I possibly could, because I always tell people I could go in a room and I know how to clear the room out with horrible stories. But I found that wasn't as beneficial and useful as being who I am, using myself as an example, and just saying, hey, I'm going to talk about these topics as I would about anything else. So, yeah, there's going to be humor. There might be laughter. I'll have a good time with it. But, you know, I'm taking it quite seriously. And when I do that, I get more curious responses and questions sent my way and spoken of, and people don't leave the room and close their minds off. So we need to stop putting the flashlight underneath our chins and trying to spook people out, and just keep it casual, keep it real, because the paranormal is normal, and it's looking at us, hoping we don't figure them out. And we need to. We need to quit with the BS of, you know, oh my gosh, this stuff is too crazy. Oh, that woman's nuts. You know, just be who you are and, you know, allow people the freedom to speak about this stuff.
Yeah, definitely. That's a great way to end the interview, that is, Heidi.
Yes. Oh, yeah, no, hey. And I welcome people to write me with their stories and their questions. I have a radio show I do every Friday, you know, on InceptionRadioNetwork.com. You can hear a lot of my shows, HeidiHollis.com, and I answer people's emails, their questions, their experiences. Send your drawings, photos. DustOutlander@gmail.com. My show is called The Outlander, and I really have a good time, you know, addressing what it is that people are experiencing out there, because helping people, that's what it's all about, and beating, winning this war, it's truly necessary.
Well, that's brilliant. Thanks for being giving us your time on the show. It's been a fantastic interview. Really interesting.
I appreciate having me. This is a blast. You guys are awesome. Call me anytime.
Yes, no problem. We will do. And I wish you all the best of luck in the future.
Thank you. Same to you guys. You have an awesome day. I don't know. Is it evening over there now? It's evening, isn't
it? It's evening, yeah.
All right.
Okay. Awesome. Well, I'll say good night to you and good day to you as well. So
awesome. Take care, you guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Deb.
Well, that was Heidi. Very interesting. She's had first-hand shadow people, Hatman experience, she says. She's written about the episodes. She's also had books out where she's written about other people's encounters with the Hat Man and everything. So it's a strange, you know, theory that that all shadow people are demons and stuff, you know what I mean? So, because we've heard somewhere people have heard, she may have not have heard many stories that shadow people have helped, but we've certainly have over in this country,
yeah,
haven't we?
Not only shadow people, but black-eyed people have helped people as well.
Yeah.
I mean, you said it in one word there. She never said the D word, but that's exactly what she's talking about. These things are demons, as far as she's concerned, I think.
Yes.
I mean, there was demons or Jesus was basically what she was, Hatman and demons. Batman and Jesus, rather.
She's just said in the chat room, well, that was fun. So it was good having her on the show.
That's what I would have. I didn't really have a chance to ask. I must admit, but I was kind of monitoring the conversations in the chat room and chatting with someone online here. But that was a question I wanted to ask. You know, are these things demons? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Well, to me, that's what it sounded like.
It does sound like it, doesn't it? Yeah. A modern term.
I mean, like I put in the chat room there, what she had to say was very interesting. But I find the moment you bring your particular faith in it, it gets skewed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because you lean towards what you've been taught and brought up as a child.
Yeah.
And I think, not that that's a bad thing, but you kind of miss stuff.
Mm.
Because you're looking at it from one angle.
From the spiritual angle.
You have to move around.
Yeah.
And see what's coming from the other side sometimes.
That standard Judeo-Christian position of what the supernatural and paranormal are.
Yeah.
As we've talked before previously, as someone who's not of that faith, that's why I have difficulty with some of these conversations. But it's the war thing I found intriguing. I'd like to have known what she meant by war. What's the result of this war that she believes is going on? Are they going to take over and rule our day-to-day lives? Are they going to destroy us all? I mean,
she did mention, didn't she, that people are thinking that there's going to be the angels and demons fighting in the sky. But she believes that these shadow people are going to be causing a war.
So we're talking about the sort of the end of days.
Maybe, yeah.
From the Bible.
Right, well, let me just tell you what's coming up next week. We have Tracy Ash on the show. She's going to be talking about ancient Egyptian celestial healing. Tracy is an established author and has published books through Findhorn Press.
Yeah, Findhorn.
And O-Books. She's an ancient Egyptian wisdom keeper, earth power sight expert, consciousness researcher, and a positive change campaigner. She is a master of meditation, awareness, and transformation. You could say that Tracy is a master high frequency magic creator, but that would only be skimming the surface. Okay. Tracy has toured the world exploring power sites and working to inspire the next generation of positive change influencers in order to ignite incredible solutions for the next phase of planetary evolution. Ancient Egyptian celestial healing is a simple transformation and awareness super technology for the 21st century, and the book is for individuals passionate about the essential how-to on new transformations and humanity frontiers for magnificent self and world change contributions.
That was a mouthful.
And I will be reading that this week. So Heidi's just put in the in the chat room that The Secret War was written in 97 and published in 2001. Gwilly, I'm assuming she means Rosemary. We've had her on the show. Rosemary Grilly also hints at a war. One wonders who published it first. Gwilly published hers last year, I think, she said. I have her on my show. So basically, she's in the chat room now if you want to ask her some questions, okay? I'm sure she won't mind asking a few questions that might have been missed. There you go, Andy, you can ask her a question. Andy, are you still there? Andy's disappeared.
He needs to come back because it's his turn.
Oh, he's just said be right back.
He's back.
Heidi's there and taking questions in the chat room at the moment. So there you go.
See, guys, that's what happens when you only listen and don't get involved in the chat room. You can't ask your questions.
Yes.
Not only while we're doing the interview, but Heidi's actually there now, and you could ask her stuff yourself.
Yeah, she's actually in the chat room, Andy.
Yes, I see, indeed.
Yes, answering questions. So she says, thanks, Steve.
You're welcome.
So, but yes, all good fun. So, oh dear me. So she's also mentioned about the secret wall there as well. So if you want to ask her about that, Andy.
I am,
she says.
Oh, if there is a war going on and they win, what happens to us?
Yes. So, Heidi was the first to write about shadow people and gave them their names in her book, including Hat Man, so, which is what I said at the top of the show.
Yes.
So, okay. So I'm going to leave Heidi to answer any questions that are in there. And before we go into Andy's section, I have an announcement to make.
Ooh. Oh, blimey.
Oh, announcements.
Announcement.
Da-da-dun.
Da-da-dun.
That was loud.
The Weird Weekend has seen 17 years of the event, which is held... we'll see 17 years this year, which is held in Heartland, North Devon, every August. Okay? But if that's too far from where you live... then don't fear, as there's going to be a weird weekend north in 2016 as well.
Oh, yes.
It's being held on the 2nd and 3rd of April at the Rixton with Glazebrook Community Hall in Warrington, and is a must for anyone interested in ghost Fortean, fairies, folklore, cryptozoology and other fascinating stuff. Just 14 miles from Manchester and less than 30 miles from Liverpool, Weird Weekend North is easy to get to with excellent motorway and transport links. It's a two-day event which gives investigators a chance to share their experiences and findings with like-minded people, and is also an ideal introduction to newcomers to the world of the unusual, and promises to be a fascinating weekend. And if it's anything like the one that was down in North Devon, in Biddeford, it's going to be great.
It's going to be good.
And we're going to be there.
Yes.
Da-da-da-da.
Yes, we are going.
We are going to do some filming.
Which one?
The North one.
The North one.
I'm not going back to Biddeford.
I might have to go see you for that thing, because the thing is, for me, in the southeast, North or Devon, about as far away as each other. So you could do one over here. The southeast would be useful.
So we've been cordially invited, me and Steve, and we're going to do some filming there.
Oh, just the two of you? Oh, I see. Oh,
yeah.
You're quite welcome.
Oh, I see.
You're quite welcome to join, but unfortunately you will have to pay for a ticket.
Yeah, unfortunately. I only asked whether I could do some filming like I did down in Biddeford, so to do some interviews, that's all. So that's why I'm going.
Oh, I see. Well, I might well get a ticket and come in. When is it? What's the date?
2nd and 3rd of April.
April? For yes. October?
No, oh, April.
April.
It's August.
April. No, the one in Biddeford is August.
Oh, I see.
No, the one in
Biddeford.
I'll have
to chat room at the same time. Yes.
Yes. Yeah, so if you want to book your tickets, that's where you need to go to. I can't remember. I think it's £15 for the day or something. £20 for the 2 days or something. I can't remember now. Let me just double check. I'll let you know. Tickets. £15 per day or £20 for 2 days. Yes. That's how much it is. So.
I think I'm going to have to come up and join you guys for that. And I'll buy my own ticket. But yeah, I think so. Yes.
Yes. So could be interesting.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I am. Some interesting people talking.
Yeah. So, we might be able to find some... interesting interviewers.
Mm.
Yes.
So there's that thing. So
it should take me camera with the
and
discs,
because that's what we did when we went to Biddeford. We're always invited down there, but it's a bit too far for us to go, as well as the camping and everything. And then they did one up north, so I asked Glenn whether we could possibly come along and do some recording, and obviously I said we won't interfere with the speakers. Speaking. And he said, yeah, not a problem. So I thought, great.
Oh, there's one that just Heidi then, the hooded entities. What are they for? What are they here for, by Steve Jones? I mean, that's up her street, isn't it?
Yes. So, yeah, there is quite a few speakers on there. Just to give you an idea. You've got History of Fairy Sightings, Hooded Entities, which you've just mentioned, The Health and Safety Beast, Urban Legends from the Heart of the Haunted City, Phenomenomics. Phenomenomics.
Is it say when you're sober?
Hunt Emerson's 14 comic. Talking about phantom hitchhikers is Rob Gandy. The Warmington Souling play, whatever that is.
I wonder what earth that is.
The Overlapping of Worlds, The Paranormal Explained. Tasmanian Wolf, Richard Freeman.
Oh, good old Richard.
Richard will be there. It'd be worth going to that. So you thinking about coming up then?
I think so. Would you be driving to it and stay, or are you going to camp or what?
No.
We'll be driving to it and coming home again.
We'll be coming home again.
Definitely. I'm not doing any camping.
No, it's only up the road.
Yes.
Yeah. If we was going to Biddeford, we'll be camping. I say, it's only, as he says, it's about 15 miles away.
Yeah, put it in the diary. I'll check out the old train times and costs, etc. But yeah, I think so. And maybe we'll come up and join you for that.
Yeah, why not? So... 14 miles away it is from here, so it's not too far.
Mm-hmm.
So all good fun. Right, it's time for your spot.
And he's fine.
Bloody. Bloody.
Andy's mystery and conspiracy files.
Okay, guys, had a good hunt around. One of the things Steve and I were talking about earlier on today is there is not a lot of stuff in the news at the moment. It seems all gone a bit dry. The stranger news themes don't seem to be around so much. But I did manage to find a few. There's my first coming up. Little tale that's been doing the rounds for a while. Now, the interesting thing about this particular news story is it has popped up on various sites, and they always reference it back to this one for the origin of this particular story, which is Putin, Russia is ready to show proof that 9/11 was an inside job. This one was written on the 15th of January, but I'm sure I read this story last year as well. But anyway, Russian President Vladimir Putin has named the date he plans to release proof that the US government and intelligence agencies were responsible for the controlled demolition, in quotes, of the World Trade Center on the 9/11 attacks. Like a boxer confident of his own strength, that's a strange analogy, Putin has been absorbing pressure from the US and biding his time, waiting for the right moment to strike. The evidence is so explosive, and I'm sure that's a pun, he knows he only has to hit once. According to Kremlin insiders, note is completely unnamed and unidentifiable, President Putin has named September 11th, 2016 as the date he plans to release the satellite footage proving conclusively that the US government's darkest secret, that the 9/11 attacks were a false flag terrorist event committed against its own citizens. The US government's secret terrorist activities at home and internationally will be exposed, undermining the credibility of the nation on the world stage and proving that Putin is the only major world leader truly fighting terrorism and the darker forces. I think I've seen Star Wars too many times. It's well known that Putin is a fan of synchronicity. Oh, I didn't know that. But there's more to the September 11th from the 2016 date than the simple anniversary of the attacks. It is also the beginning of a politically volatile period in the US. Do not forget, the US government's darkest secret is their biggest Achilles heel, if I can say the words. The blow will hit hard, the mass protests in the cities and the responsible public anger will lead to a popular uprising, culminating in almost certainly in revolution. The government will be completely destroyed and the new world order they support will be thrown into chaos. 2016 is the year Putin has vowed to destroy the Illuminati. Ooh. The simple step of choosing the right moment to take advantage of the great American Achilles heel will be his first step towards shaking up the status quo and fulfilling his promise. Now, the thing is of this story, it is totally bereft of any references to anything. No names mentioned, no other sources you can find, and every other version that's put this story out has linked it to this same page. It's just nonsense. It's just I find it amazing these things even get put out, because there's no referencing to nothing here. And I just find it's crazy. What do you think, guys?
I'm inclined to agree with you, to be honest, mate. I'm trying to agree with you. I don't know where they get all this rubbish from.
I just find it amazing that this, obviously, it's one of those things I think we've kind of realised now with the conspiracy side of things, that those, we used to say of ghosts, about those who believe no proof is necessary. I think we've come to conspiracy people, they don't need evidence to believe there's a conspiracy, they'll just believe there's a conspiracy. And if you write a story talking about conspiracy, they're going to believe it. Now, it might be that maybe he has got some secret information, but I'd like to know if it's that secret and world-shattering information. How did the person who wrote this article discover this information? Because it's by the Conspiracy Club. It doesn't even name a writer of the article, just the website as being the author of the article. And think, yes. I mean, you could write, anyone could write anything. That's the problem with the internet. Anyone can write just about anything. Anyway, my next story, which was a little bit more down to earth, but equally a little odd, I think. I've just lost the page. Hold on a second. I was end up having about 10 pages open all at the same time, which is never a good idea, so I'll lose what I'm supposed to put. Anyway, here's my next one. Have a look at this. For £21, pills for sale on Amazon allow you to control your dreams. A dream-controlling pill like a sci-fi flight of fantasy worthy of Inception or The Matrix. But nightmare sufferers could finally be set for a good night's sleep thanks to a herbal lucid dreaming remedy on sale on Amazon. Interesting, they've got an E on the end of Amazon. Well, I assume it's a typo, but maybe there's some other alternative to Amazon app. They're called Amazon. Anyway, Dreamleaf, a special mixture of herbs and nutrients, costs £21 a pot. The red and blue pills, I wonder where they got that idea from. Said by manufacturers to encourage lucid dreaming. Scientists behind the products claim Dreamleaf is the most advanced, effective product of its kind on the market. Blue pill consists of antidepressant supplement 5-HTP, which I know a lot about, and it doesn't induce any kind of strange dreams. A health food favourite. The red pill contains herbs, nutrients to promote rational thinking. Amazon notoriously fickle reviewers have given the product a ringing endorsement. Yes, the Amazon reviewers are notoriously fickle, aren't they, Della? She knows what I mean by that. One said the pills were amazing. They wrote, I have total control, just desire and the world turns. I've flown, I've visited many places, I've created islands of fantasy, I've piloted a plane with this, and my first bottle, an effortlessness. I love it. I think that's called marijuana, isn't it? Anyway.
I have one question for you.
Yes.
Which pill would you take?
I always look for the green one myself.
So you don't want to go down the rabbit hole?
Well, I think life is down a rabbit hole anyway. I've been down and back up again. I find the idea interesting. I mean, it's something that I think you can do, control your dreams lucidly. A lucid dream itself, of course, is a dream that's extremely real and feels as if it's actually happening. Now, one of the things I can say from people I work with who've had sort of concerns, issues, what have I, often do recommend 5-HTP as a way of helping if you're suffering with anxiety or depression, because it is very effective. And whether that can cause strong dreams, I don't know, because I do have clients who say that's what they experience. But whether it's the 5-HTP or my very good psychotherapy, I don't know. But 5-HTP can be effective against depression and anxiety. But as to causing lucid dreams, I'd say I wouldn't know. But the other one, the other pill, it's a bit strange. It says no more about what's in it, which I think is always a bit concerning. You need to know really what you're taking. If it's just herbal, you should know what it is you're taking. Anyway, that's that one. Anyone fancy trying those pills?
No.
Okay.
No, thank you.
Next one is an interesting article in itself. I probably won't read all of it because it's actually quite long, but I've highlighted it for a couple of reasons, which I'll go into and I'll stick it up. There we go. I thought quite funny that they ended up with the end of the shortened URL was Bexy. So just happened to notice that. And she came up with both random letters, it actually came up with a woman's name. Scientific evidence hints that advanced civilizations were around before the Big Bang. This is UFO International report. But certainly some of the names mentioned in the article I'm actually very familiar with in terms of the writers. We see the universe as being as old as one could imagine. But could it be that there is an extraterrestrial civilizations out there who've been around a lot longer? Scientific evidence suggests yes. It was a Professor Roger Penrose. There is only one Professor Penrose, and that's Professor Roger Penrose from the University of Oxford, UK. Now, interestingly, there is no such place as the University of Oxford. There are 20 different colleges that form the University of Oxford. There has to be one of those. But anyway, that's a sideline. And Vara Gerzadian, which in itself sounds like it could be an alien, but I do believe it's a real person, from the Centre of Cosmology and Astrophysics, Akhlindrian National Laboratory and Yerevan State University, Yerevan, Armenia, who have recently published a cosmic map and identified the places on our universe where advanced super civilizations could have existed before the Big Bang happened. In an intriguing scientific study, the leading researchers examine the anomalies in the map of the cosmic microwave background, which they interpret as evidence of the existence of technology advanced societies of a time before the emergence of our universe. If proven correct, this could change the way we look at our existence in the universe forever. With this completely revolutionary theory, the leading researchers created a detailed map on which they marked the potential existence of possible higher civilizations and numerous red dots on the map. Researchers and scientists have suggested that given the current data, it is possible that there have been identified long-lost habitats of super civilizations that inhabited the universe before the Big Bang. Now, the first thing I've noticed in this article is it likes to repeat itself rather a lot. It seems to be saying the same thing over and over again. But I shall read on. The two leading researchers have raised extremely interesting questions referencing the community known as the Fermi Paradox. Numerous expectations have been risen from this theory. Our civilization wasn't the first to have come into existence in our cosmic neighborhood. It is possible that many super advanced civilizations predate our very own, predating advanced life on our planet, and technology developing by hundreds of thousands of centuries. Well, yeah, maybe possible. But let's just read about the Fermi Paradox. It refers to a puzzle that arises from the expectation that our own civilization is unlikely to have been the first to have risen throughout our galactic neighborhood. And if ours was not the first then, owing to the randomness involved in the timing of factors that lead to its development, the likelihood would be that our civilization would have preceded by others, having an advantage of thousands of centuries of technological development. The expectation then would be that such enormously advanced civilizations would have had ample opportunity to have there been visited us, or at least sent decipherable signals to us by now. Basically, what it's saying in simple terms is that the chances are there are older civilizations than ours out there, and if there are, they've been around a lot longer. Why haven't we heard from them yet? Of course, the ancient alien theorists would say that's exactly what we've got. We've got abundance of evidence around that these things have visited us in the ancient past, and I'm sure von Daniken would agree. Yeah, Roger Penrose proposed the theory of psychic cosmology.
I would say they're not stupid enough to get involved with us. everything we touch just gets destroyed somewhere along the line.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I mean, I have a couple. I'll shut up, you. Had a little puppy. Yes. I have a couple of problems with this.
Yes.
Really. One, yeah, I can say I'm pretty sure that there's other civilizations out there somewhere that quite possibly could have turned up before we did.
Yes.
But how could they have turned up before the universe existed in the first place?
Well, this is where it all starts to fall down a bit. Now, I was trying to do a bit more research on this afternoon, but other things got in the way. Because I have read before about, in fact, I'm a big fan of Roger Penrose's work, particularly on the concepts of consciousness. He's come up with some revolutionary ideas that I think he's really onto something. His other theory that's to do with his more normal work, which is theoretical physics, is about the idea of the psychic cosmology, the idea the universe comes into existence for a while and then disappears again. Which is, I think, the case. I don't think we've ever had a Big Bang that came from absolutely nothing. We had a Big Bang prior to that was universe in pure potentiality. It was just pure energy with no form to it. And that kind of adheres with my sort of religious faith belief, if you like. We talk about the days and nights of Brahman and existence and non-existence of the universe. But as you rightly say, the whole point is that when that universe we're in now stops existing, all becomes pure energy again, then no life form can exist in just as pure energy. It becomes impossible. It just is pure energy. Therefore, by that nature, it's dispersed energy, not in any kind of form. So these things couldn't have survived. that kind of complete annihilation of physical matter, existing matter. So, and I was trying to determine whether Sir Roger Penrose is actually saying that, or they've just linked in his theory of cosmology into this notion. Firstly, it has been predicted that a huge giant black hole swallows the universe to store energy, after which the Big Bang, which forms the border between the old and the new universe. So it's not kind of a Big Bang so much anymore. But if there is this super giant black hole that swallows everything, the idea is it crushes everything down, so all matter loses form and becomes just pure energy again. It becomes formless energy as opposed to formed energy, which is what we are, essentially. So, I don't know, we are left with the same question. It doesn't really answer the question of how these things could survive utter annihilation and return to pure potentiality of energy without, you know, how would you do that? Is it some kind of, I know, kind of space bubble that they wrap around themselves that means that they're no longer affected by the universe around collapsing? But then everything is of that universe, so therefore it seems unlikely that anything could survive. Anyway, we're going to get a bit too technical now, I think, perhaps. But I just thought it was an interesting theory that this idea of these super ancient civilizations that are going to be around longer than ours, much older than ours, that could have somehow survived the end of the universe and the rebirth of another universe. Anyway, I'll go and find something much more interesting to talk about. Hold on.
No, it's interesting. It just goes above my head a bit.
It does get a bit, it got a bit bogged down, I have to say. Initially, it looked quite a good little story, but it did as a... I didn't read all of it earlier on, I must confess. I've been trying to fix a cabinet at home. So, anyway, here's my final story, and I think this is a bit more down to earth, if you like. X-Files creator. I thought the FBI was going to shut me down. A mysterious man told Chris Carter that his conspiracy-themed TV classic was too close to the truth. Ooh, mysterious man, eh? Alien conspiracies, monsters, cryptids, mutants, paranormal phenomena are just a typical day for the fictional FBI agents of The X-Files. But how close to fiction was it? Creator, writer and director Chris Carter tells a real-life tale about the show and its early days that's worthy of the show's catchphrase, "The truth is out there." I had someone come up to me during the original run of the series who said that they worked in some high place in a secret government agency and said they were very close to the truth, Carter told the Huffington Post. I don't know whether to take that person at their word or not. I can tell you this. I wrote the 1993 pilot. I called the FBI to do some research. They said they were nice enough, but didn't really give me the time of day. Then, all of a sudden, we got close to airing. The FBI called and said, "Who are you and what are you doing?" And for a second, I thought I was going to be at the long arm of the law coming round to shut me down. The science fiction classic returns to TV. And of course, this is the big clue about the article. The TV series returns after a 14-year absence. And Carter tells the HuffPost weird news that the feds eventually took a liking to him and he took a liking to them. They became unofficially fans of the X-Files and were as a member of the FBI Citizens Academy. Didn't know that. I had a chance to shoot many firearms with the FBI and got to shoot a few rounds of firing range at the FBI headquarters in Washington. Sunday night's premiere of The Long Away. I'm not going to read the rest of that because basically this article is obviously a way of promoting the new series. But it's interesting that maybe they were concerned that maybe he was treading on someone's toes a little bit about information that the FBI might have about supposed possible aliens. But it's not quite the same as the heading suggests. A mysterious man told Chris Carter that his conspiracy-themed TV classic was too close to the truth. It's in the headline, but when you reel well down again, all it actually says, he was called by them, and they said, "Who are you and what are you doing?" It's not quite the same thing as mysterious man saying it's too close to the truth.
It's maybe typical press, isn't it?
Well, he could easily have just had too much information about the way in which the FBI goes about his business. Not necessarily that he's got any secret information about aliens, just he knows the way this FBI works too well. But, yeah, so I don't know if you guys are planning to watch it, but I think I should be tuning in, even though I kind of lost interest after about the third or fourth season. And certainly when old Mulder left, I thought, how can you carry on without him? But they did, of course. I may well just tune in to see, because I remember seeing the very first episode, which is on, I think it was Channel 4, it might have been Channel 4, but it was all part of a thing called Weird Night. I had various programs dealing with strange phenomena. And
how many series was there?
Say again? Nine, actually. Nine in total.
I saw two programs.
Really? Is that it?
And the film.
I'm surprised you saw so little as that.
To be honest, it didn't really,
float
me boat.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, I thought it, after a couple of seasons, it started to get a bit bogged down in itself, became sort of inflated by its own self-importance, in the same sort of way that things like Friends, you know, the comedy series, that started off absolutely brilliantly, but
I've only seen about two of those as well.
As the actors and actresses in it got more and more famous, they were demanded to have more and more screen time. So they had to actually write episodes that had all four, six of them with equal time on screen. If one had more than another one, there was uproar. It was like, that's ridiculous. How can you write and film like that? But that's what they had to do with Friends. And I think really with X-Files, it kind of went on a bit too far. After a few seasons, it was kind of retreading the same ground a bit, and it was just dragging out over and over again the same storylines, getting very slow in their unveiling of them. So I got a bit bored. But I probably was tuning in just to see it come back, because I think the fact that you've got Fox Mulder back in again will make a difference. But we should see.
I know our Joan Bill is a big X-Files fan.
Yeah, well, it was a very popular show.
Yeah,
so.
He's got all the series down on CD.
Ah. Well, that's it for me, guys. That's my stories for this week. As I say, it was a bit slim pickings, unfortunately, but there's nothing to do a lot about at the moment. Not much weird stuff's happening other than usual. I mean, there are hundreds of UFO pictures of strange little dots in the sky. And interestingly, I found myself thinking this afternoon about UFO photographs, how so many of them all tend to be little dots far away in the sky, where there rarely seem to be good close-up photographs of UFOs. So I do think that's a question that needs to be looked at. That if you see a UFO picture, we almost expect it to be some kind of blurred little dot in the sky far away. And as soon as we see something that is more apparently close up, we always think of good old Photoshop. But if you think about it, if you see an aircraft in the sky that looks, as you look at it with your own eyesight, quite big, then take a photograph of it and have a look at it. And you notice quite often that it's actually a lot smaller than you think it is when you look at it. Because our eyes, we can focus our eyes, obviously, on small things, but there's an odd effect in the human brain where what we're looking at actually enlarges. That it's almost like we do have telescopic vision, that we can make something look much bigger than it actually is because we're focusing our eyes on it, an object in the sky. It's like the good one to do is the moon. If you look at the moon, it looks quite large. But if you don't use your phone to take a photograph of it and look at the photograph, think, that seems smaller than the moon I'm looking at. And that's because that's how it works. So it could be people are photographing UFOs that are actually relatively close by, but because they're small objects in a very big sky, they appear to be further away than they actually are. So it was just a thought, you know.
All about perception, isn't it?
Absolutely, very much so. It is how our brains process, and the fact of the matter is how our brains process what we see, and what we actually see, if you take a photograph of it, can often be slightly different, or very different in some cases. Particularly like human hearing, you know, if you listen to a person talking to you in an otherwise busy room, you can usually hear what they're saying. But if you then try and record it at the same time, you'll notice the background noise is often much louder than you realise it is, because your ears are focused on that person, whereas a recorder can't do that. So it tends to pick up all the sound around.
Mm.
That's it for me anyway.
Okay. Well, that's it from you. That's it from us.
Ah.
So, what you got planned for this week? Not a lot?
No, usual. Actually, business has picked up quite nicely. I've had quite a couple of weeks, made a few inquiries, so work's looking a bit better. Not my shells, really. Just still working on the redrawing of the art images. Well, not art, really, just images for my rune book, which my publisher definitely wants. Just a case of getting the imagery correct for it. So I'll have to keep you busy for a while. Other than that, that's it.
Okay.
I've got some research to do.
Yes, of the rock and roll kind.
Oh, yes.
Ah.
The show is picking up. It's successful, and we've decided to extend our 12-week run and not be a seasonal show. And
Well, hopefully same here with mine, actually.
All good fun.
They're like mine too, yours. We were just saying, it's funny how you couldn't get two music shows more different than your sort of 60s stuff and my electronic music. It's quite funny, really, but how far away they are, but never mind.
Yeah, on Sue's blog version of it, I'll say for one of a better word, the last three, she had 80 listeners.
68.
And then it dropped down to 20-something for the 60s one.
Yeah.
And then back up to 68 for the rock and roll one.
So it tells me that I need to stick with my rock and roll and rockabilly.
Mm. Just out of interest, where did you get the figures from to know?
Because I put it on Spreaker.
Oh, yes, you said about it. I must do that with mine, actually.
Yeah, I put them on Spreaker, and then I put the links onto my group page on Facebook. So they're obviously getting it from my Facebook page.
Yeah, so whenever anybody clicks on it to listen, it registers on Spreaker.
But it seems to be doing well. Ray said it's doing well in the States and everything.
That's good.
So, I'm getting good figures on there as well.
That's good. So, it's very much American style music, though, isn't it, I suppose?
It is these days, I must admit, because, it seems to have had a revival, some time ago. So, but my show being different because I give information as well.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Whereas most rock and roll shows, it's basically back-to-back music.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I'm giving information about the song, etc.
I kind of copied your format with my show as well. I talk a little bit about the tracks and the artists, who they are, and it's a bit waffle between tracks as well. So I thought it was a good idea just to give people an idea of who it is they listen to. Yeah.
Do you know what I find paranormal about it?
What's that then?
Well, when we were down south, all the bands were up here.
Yeah.
Now we're up here, all the bands are down south. Are they scared of us?
Well, most of my artists I play from are in Europe, so, well, we're in Europe, obviously, but the mainland Europe. So, yeah, unfortunately, it's a genre that's never really picked up massively over here. When we have electronic music, we tend to think of pop chart electronics, which I do not play. I mean, I say don't. A few tracks, like sort of Enigma and The Orb, kind of have had pop hits, if you like, chart hits.
Gary Newman?
Come.
Gary Newman?
No, too poppy.
Too poppy.
Yeah.
David Bowie?
No, he's not electronic.
He went electronic for a little while.
A few tracks, yeah, did some, but no, I mean, that was just his wander into it. The most sort of popular commercial I've played so far would be Kraftwerk, really.
Guys, right. As great as our music shows are, this is a paranormal show.
Yes. Yes.
But it gives a promotion.
We're having a crossover.
We're having a crossover. So, at least it tells you a little bit about what we're into.
About what we do.
Yeah. And what we're not, other side.
We're not just paranormal.
Mm-hmm.
No, this is it.
Oh, yes.
So, so that's basically it for tonight. And let me just get what I got to get to. It's been great having you listening to us in the chat room. I hope you've enjoyed tonight's show, as we've enjoyed your company, and look forward to seeing you next week from 8 p.m. on www.ktpf.co.uk.
Yes. And as always, a big thank you to our guest Heidi, and thank you for listening to the KTPF Community Talk Show, which is supported by Phenomena Magazine and Beyond Parazine.
Yes.
Yeah. So don't forget, next week we have Tracy Ash on talking about ancient ancestral celestial healing. No, that wasn't what it was it? Let me try that again. Ancient Egyptian celestial healing, that was it.
Well, you're halfway there. You were three quarters of the way there.
Yeah. As I say, she is an ancient wisdom keeper, globally active teacher and writer, conscious parent, publisher, researcher and honorary member of the PSI Psychic Institute in Japan.
What's a conscious parent? Most parents are conscious normally.
I know. I hope so, anyway.
Not as your parents are unconscious.
Hopefully we'll find out.
Yes. So until next time, it's good night from me.
And it's good night from her.
And it's good night from the shadow people. Ooh.
And until next time, all that's left to say is
keep the paranormal friendly. Night, guys.
Good night and God bless.
Night all.
This is where it's at.
From ghoulies and ghosties and long-legged beasties and things that go bump in the night, visit our ghost store, and next time you might be able to show what just gave you a fright.
So for all of your investigation needs, with over 100 products in stock waiting for dispatch within 24 hours, you need to visit theukghoststore.com.